Welcome back. Now we're going to hit the most important step in the early phase of modeling, and that's when we turn our ingredients into relationships that can come together to form explanations. We're going to call these hypotheses. What did we just learn? What we saw is that the noisy self-motion signal could be processed in a way that we could detect the presence of motion when it was there and distinguish it from when there was no motion, but that it wasn't perfectly reliable. The best overall performance that we could achieve when we take into account both kinds of errors is 72% correct, and that's shown in this purple line. But overall, there remained a confusability, and it's possible that this confusion between when we're moving and when we're not moving is really instrumental in generating the solution. So step four, we formulate our hypotheses. The way to think about formulating hypotheses is that we want to chain together the causes, the understanding that we have of the key ingredients, the inputs, the outputs, and put them into a form where we have a set of equations, relations, code, which represents the possible explanation. Each possible explanation we generate is its own hypothesis, and it deserves its own model. So what we're going to do is we're going to focus on making a model per hypothesis, where each hypothesis expresses a way in which we think the illusion might occur. One of the most straightforward ways to make this step systematic is that you can write down all of the ingredients that you have and then try to encode the relationships between those ingredients in a set of equations. Here I'm going to focus on algebraic equations because they're the most familiar, hopefully, to all of you, and we don't have to teach you anything for you to understand what's in this slide. What I've done is I've placed a list of all of the variables we identified in the ingredient phase. The first two variables are the actual motions that the participant experienced during the experiment. The self-motion, which was sometimes zero and sometimes one, and the world motion, those are the actual things that are experienced, and the ones with hats on them, the V-hat and VW-hat, are the data that we're trying to explain. These are the slider judgments that our participants generated for us. The signals that the participants had available are the inputs to the model. These are the vestibular info, which we can assume is already filtered and integrated according to our understanding of what the brain would be doing. And finally, we have a detection, and I'm going to give it its own variable, which is in general good practice. So self-motion detection will be called the variable Z. It will just be a Boolean variable indicating whether or not, given a threshold, the subject should have detected it. The key relationships that we know from our background and from our ingredients are algebraically that the optic flow signal can be generated equivalently by a world motion or a self-motion, or any combination of the two, but that these motions will have opposite signs. The world motion in one direction will generate the same signal as a self-motion in the opposite direction. Notice that this also means that these signals could cancel. And this noise here represents the fact that this is corrupted in a systematic way, which the brain is trying to overcome. The vestibular information is similar, except it only depends on the self-motion, together with its own noise, which is different. What we're going to do in this step is write out our hypothesis, plot the relationships that are implied by these algebraic equations, and then categorize using this variable Z, which will encode our understanding that some of the vestibular signals would be detected and some would not be. So in general, illusory self-motion will occur when, and then you'll have to identify the preconditions. We hypothesize it occurs because, and then you'll explain how our hypothesized relationships work.